I'll ask everybody to take a seat if you can, because we have a wonderful presentation, as you know, so we do want to get started on time. Give everybody a chance to come to your seat. I want to thank you all for coming to the Hanover Conservancy's 2018 annual meeting. I'm Christine McDevitt, President of the Board of Directors of the Hanover Conservancy. And we know that most of you are here to hear whales and tales from the Ocean Alliance. We have President Ian Kerr, president of the organization, is here to give us some insight into whales and how they use drones, and I think it's going to be a really fascinating discussion. I want to thank Hanover High School for allowing us to use this auditorium, and particularly the custodial staff for staying late and helping us use this venue, so thank you. Our format for the evening, you may have seen, we had a little agenda sitting out on the tables. In a few minutes, we're going to briefly celebrate our most recent land acquisition. Now, you hopefully all saw this in the Valley News. We're so excited about the Britton Forest, which we closed on just last week. So we're going to have a brief celebration for that project. Then we're going to hear from Ian Kerr, and he'll take questions, right, for about an hour. We'll be able to do that, have the talk and some questions. Following the talk, we'll have a brief two-minute leg stretch. And seriously, just 2 minutes, because then we'll have our business meeting portion of this evening, which is really just about 15 minutes. You'll hear from our vice president, a brief financial overview from our treasurer, and then most importantly, we're going to be voting on four new board members for the Hanover Conservancy's board. These four candidates were unanimously approved by our current board of directors, and we need confirmation from our voting membership so they can join our board, so we hope you'll stay for that vote. We have been busy this year, and I just want to give you a few highlights. Among our accomplishments are the new Chapman Trail on Balch Hill. I hope you've had a chance to see that trail, built with generous support of our former board member, Rob Chapman, and his wife, Jan, and neighbors on Balch Hill. We worked with the Hanover Conservation Commission Trails Committee and opened the Audrey McCollum Trail at Hayes Farm Park in Etna. This was, again, with donations from family and friends of wonderful community member Audrey McCollum, who many of you knew. We now have this great link between the Etna Library and the King Bird Sanctuary, linking to Woodcock Lane over as you go up Trescott. We've expanded our reach in the schools. We continue to utilize Dr. Bob Christie's generous gift that he made to us. We bring the Connecticut River Science Program to the Richmond Middle School science classes. It's really a wonderful collaboration and fun for them and fun for us. And our outreach coordinator, Courtney Draga, has developed and is leading something we're calling Wednesday Wanders. It's an extremely popular outdoor adventure program for CAST, which is the Kids After School program at the Ray School. And we've received wonderful feedback on that. We encourage you, as always, to visit our website to hear about our trips. We have monthly trips led by local experts and board members, gets you outside. You can see some of these open spaces in Hanover that you might not have known about. Or you can always go to our website and download our hike of the month. You can get maps, information, plan your own adventure. We've got lots of information on our website, so I hope you take a chance to look at it. I also hope you've taken a look at our annual report. You'll learn much more about what we do and everything we've done over the past year. We're really excited about our accomplishments. It's all in here. And we're trying something new this year. With this annual report, we sent our annual appeal letter. You will not be receiving another end of year letter. This is it for this year. In 2016, 2017, we were really excited to learn that we had successfully met with your contributions in 2016-17. We'd successfully met the Byrne Foundation's two-year match challenge. So we received a wonderful match gift this year. And I am thrilled to announce that once again, we have learned that they are supporting our mission wholeheartedly and have issued a new $100,000 match challenge for us. So we hope you can help us reach that challenge with your year-end gift. We've got annual reports, I believe, outside in the lobby. There's a remittance envelope in the report, of course, or you can also go to our website to donate. Lastly, I'd like to introduce the Hanover Conservancy's current board members. I have my contacts in, so I can't see distance, so I'm just going to ask you to stand up one by one, and then if you'd all hold your applause till the end. Folks, these are your neighbors and friends who spend so much time behind the scenes protecting the natural resources in Hanover, and I'd like you to see who they all are. I serve on many boards in the Upper Valley, and by far, this is the most engaged, fun, energetic group of people, and I want you to know who they all are. So, let me say your names. Jim Wooster, stand please. Dudley Smith, Ann Malenka, Karen Geiling, Stan Kala, Erica Van Sitters, Ryan Johnson, Heidi Tremarco, and our four departing members. We're sad to say goodbye to our friends and board members whose terms have ended, but we believe in continuously revitalizing our boards, hence the vote we're going to be taking later. So we're saying goodbye to Tom Jack, who is not here. He's out of town, actually. He wasn't able to be here tonight. Jay Pearson, Hugh Mellert, and Nancy Collier. Can we give them all a big hand? To our two wonderful staff members. We have Courtney Draga, who has helped us for several years. She's now on board full-time as our outreach coordinator, and she's doing a fantastic job. And of course, Adair Mulligan, our tireless and fearless leader, who's led us on such a successful trip these past, 8 years now, okay? And does a fantastic job as well. And most of you know Adair or have met her. So I am going to pass the microphone to Adair, and we are going to celebrate our second victory.
I am thrilled that you are all here to help us celebrate the protection of the Britton Forest, 79 acres of lovely forest and habitat on Moose Mountain. And I think on the upper left-hand side, you can see in blue the approximate location of this property, and you can also see how well it plugs a hole in the protected land that surrounds it now on the northwest slope of Moose Mountain. On the east side, over here, is Appalachian Trail corridor land protected by the federal government. This is our own Mayor Niles Forest that was given to us in 2013 by Michael and Lily Mayer and John Niles. And then on the north side is an 80-acre tract owned by the town of Hanover. So you can see the first reason why we're all excited about this. A number of other reasons we're thrilled with it. On the left-hand side, I don't think I have ever been on a piece of property that had more bear sign close by than this one in particular. And it's really quite extraordinary. There's wonderful flora out there and many stone walls that speak to a history in the 19th century as sheep pasture. We are going to be doing an inventory of this property starting in the wintertime with a winter wildlife tracking trip. And you'll be hearing about this. We'd love to have you come out with us. Be a citizen scientist with us. Help us find what there is to learn about this property. In the springtime, we'll be visiting it to look for wildflowers and spring ephemerals. And if any of you are good birders, please get on out there and let us know what you observe. The other thing that's really critical about this property is that it is the headwaters of Hughes Brook, which flows into the Connecticut River in Lyme. We don't mind doing a good thing for the town of Lyme. I mean, there are neighbors. But keeping the headwaters and the seeps, or the forested seeps that surround this, covered and clean and protected is a really good way of not only keeping water in the brook clean as it flows south through the neighborhoods and into the river, but also helps stem the problem of climate change and the heavy, heavy, severe storms that we've been getting. This almost acts like a sponge for some of those, the rain that comes in heavy storms like that. So we really are addressing with this wonderful new property two different aspects of climate change resilience. One is keeping unfragmented large blocks of habitat free and protected so the wildlife can roam there, and then protecting flood security as well. So the thrill here is this lovely gift that came from Doug and Catherine Britton of Norris. This land has been in Doug's family for almost 75 years. And he was kind enough to make a gift of this land, along with a generous contribution to the stewardship fund that will help us take care of it for many years to come. And this just happened last Wednesday, and we're quite excited about it. So before we give a round of applause to them, I want to present Catherine with her own new lid, because Doug has his. And also, something to put on your wall to remember us by. And in case the photo isn't the one that matches your decor, there's some alternatives in there. Courtney thinks of everything. Thank goodness people can do that. Now it's my pleasure to introduce Ian Kerr. Boy, are we thrilled about this. Courtney and I have been looking at the imagery that displays Ian's work for a couple of months now, and we've been so excited about this evening. Ian is the CEO of the Ocean Alliance. It's a nonprofit research organization founded in 1971 by South Woodstock resident Roger Payne, who I understand is here with us tonight. Thank you all. For decades, the Ocean Alliance has been leading the worldwide effort to research and protect marine life for healthier oceans, and we need to remember that everything that goes down a storm drain and into streams and rivers here in Hanover ends up in Roger's territory, where you're meeting. So we need to think about this. Shortly after studying engineering at the University of London in the 1980s, Ian met Roger at his whale camp in Argentina and has worked with him ever since. As CEO, Ian leads research expeditions all over the globe and has helped develop new technology, which you have seen on display tonight, to help biologists research and conserve threatened marine life. We are really indebted to our friend Lindy McNamara in the front row, who is one of our indefatigable volunteers and a member of our Community Engagement Committee, who has known Ian for quite some time and was able to persuade him to pay a trip inland. Thank you. So we're excited to have Ian join us, and thank you very much.
Yes, so no pressure for me having the founder and president of Ocean Alliance sitting in the front row. But as Roger said, and thank you to the Hanover Conservancy for inviting me, you know, I appreciate the fact that you did, and you sort of took the words out of my mouth, but people don't realize all this stuff is washing down into the ocean. So it doesn't matter how far inland you leave, you have an ocean effect. And of course, Lindy McNamara, can't thank her enough. You know, she's Ocean Alliance's Energizer Bunny. She's our Director of Development. If you pick up the phone and someone says Lindy Mac, you know you're going on a good journey and a good cause. So we're lucky to be sharing her with you. Okay, I'm ready with the lights, if you are. All right, so there's going to be a few takeaways tonight. And I think the first takeaway is going to be, we live on planet ocean. We don't live on planet Earth. Whoever called it Earth, they're fired, okay? We live on planet ocean. 71% of our planet is covered by water. And this is the only math section I'm going to do tonight. If people are worried it's going to be a math talk, you're okay. But I want to say 71% is covered by water, and then each country has its exclusive economic zone that goes 200 miles offshore. So they own the waters 200 miles offshore. So if you subtract all the waters that are owned by the different nations from the 71%, you actually have 64%. So 64% of the planet are considered high seas or international waters. And when you reflect that 64% to the whole planet, it actually means almost half of the planet belongs to nobody. Or, if you think of it a better way, half of the planet belongs to everybody. This is our waters. It's not China, it's not France. These are our waters, these are our oceans. And as Roger says, when a whale swims around Cape Horn, it doesn't go, woohoo, I'm in the Pacific. It's one ocean, planet ocean. And in fact, obviously I'm a Brit, and in England there was a gentleman called Garrett Hardin that talked about the tragedy of the commons, the commons lands that were being used by all, but not really being protected. And I think the 21st century tragedy of the commons, a little bit, are our oceans, because everything's inexorably washing down into our oceans. And as Roger would say, the oceans are downhill from everything, and gravity never sleeps. So I think the good news, I'm an optimist, you've got to be in this business, but I think we also need to understand that humanity's future is in our oceans. As we're filling up our land masses, as we're using all the resources, we're going to have to be looking to our oceans for the products we need, and beyond recreation. So don't worry, I'm not going to go over all of these lists, but I want you to realize that, you know, there is a new blue economy underway. And what Ocean Alliance does, we're a conservation science group, is when somebody's doing some work, we go in and say, well, okay, this is a breeding area or it isn't a breeding area. We do sort of conservation-based science. So we don't do science just for the sake of doing science. We typically do science for a mission. Now the bad news, and this isn't going to be a bad news talk, but the bad news is, with all of these things happening in the oceans, okay, you know, whales are facing more threats than ever before. And I will admit, Roger and I have talked about this, it's a little bit depressing. Imagine building a house for 30 years, and at the end of 30 years, it's in worse shape than when you started. You know, when I started, it was just basically commercial whaling, and now we've got ship strikes and whatever, and acoustic bleaching. What the heck is acoustic bleaching? Well, don't worry, we'll get there. And a lot of people don't realize whales are actually doing good. A lot of whales are off the endangered species list. Now, that doesn't mean they're out of trouble. Just because you're a little bit above endangered, I don't think there's a single population that's close to its original population. But look at all these species. All of these species are critically endangered. There's over 10 species there critically endangered. The Yangtze ribbing dolphin was basically wiped out in 2013. The vaquita in Sea Cortez is basically functionally extinct. And I just think, you know, what are the fruits of this intelligence that we as a species has? What are the fruits of our intelligence? Well, I think, you know, having intelligent, social, sort of cooperative species like this wiped out forever, I don't think is an indicator of intelligence. And FYI, the most endangered whale actually in North America is a species of whale called the Brutus whale. Okay, it's spelled Brides, but it's a Brutus whale, and it lives down in the Gulf of Mexico. Here, the Deepwater Horizon disaster was around here, and there are 30 of these animals left. And I just say this, and I'm not dropping a fundraising hint, but imagine if you say to somebody, I want to go and study the most endangered whale, you know, in North America. By the way, there's only 30 of them, so I could spend 2 months down there and only see two of them. You know, it's a real catch-22 when you're working with critically endangered species. Ocean Alliance is hoping to go back to the Gulf of Mexico in 2020, because we did work in the Gulf after the Deepwater Horizon disaster. And remember I talked about acoustic bleaching? Whales live in a world of sound. We live in a world of sight, but most of you that have gone snorkeling, often you can't see 10, 15 feet in front of you. And this world of sound is something that Roger's written a lot about. Roger was the one that discovered that humpback whales sing songs. But I'm going to play you a seismic exploration sound here. So hang on, let me just see if this... So that's a sperm whale. It's just sending out... And that's a sonar gun exploring for oil. Every 10 seconds, often for a week, non-stop. I mean, I have to say, I can only think of my one dog, you know, which barks sometimes. But can you imagine that? And the only problem with the Gulf of Mexico is like this giant bathtub, and these sounds are echolocating through the ocean. And I'll move on, but there's another great image here I got from actually one of Roger's students, who's now, he's retired, but was one of the top bioacoustic people in North America. Chris Clark put down all these little recording devices off Boston. Can you see that? So Boston's here, Gloucester here, Provincetown. And he put down all of these underwater recording devices to record right whales, all right? All of these little dots are right whales. Now these big dots, anywhere within this blue, if you were a whale, you couldn't hear another whale. Does that make sense? So any of these areas you can't hear. The little blue dots are the right whales, and then these big dots are when animals couldn't hear each other. So here's a slide of a 24-hour period, I think. What's this? But what's happening is we're filling up their area with sound. So is this sort of like somebody hitting them and hurting them? No, but they can't hear each other, they can't communicate. I mean, look at that. And this is all noise that's being made by boats. So, I mean, who would have thought a boat could mess up whales? But anyway, all right, we'll keep moving on. One thing Ocean Alliance has done is we've actually sold this now, looking for a new boat, but anyway. We sold this boat. I actually have to tell you, by the way, that's Roger right there. And in actual fact, I'll take a look. Well, okay, so we've sent the Odyssey around the world. We worked in the Gulf from 2010 to 2014. This boom here is what we call the whale boom. And if you imagine that was a whale, you could see that if Roger wanted to collect data from that whale, he's a lot closer. But here is the Odyssey down in the Gulf of Mexico. And we were sending this vessel around the world, collecting baseline data on ocean pollution. Here's the route again. We did 11 ecoregions. It took us over 5 years. We've got over 1,000 biopsy samples. And the bad news is, Roger and I had hoped that we'd have a baseline like pre-pollution. Do you know what I mean? We could get a baseline before the oceans were polluted. And some of the remotest parts of the planets, we found high levels of pollutants. And I just look at this one. This is mercury levels in whales. And so 0.3 parts per million, after that it's considered toxic. Look at this, we've got 2.5, right? It's at 100 times, I think that's right, 100 times more toxic than the US government considers safe. So it's a problem. All right, that's my foundation. We're now gonna move on to some fun stuff. I'm a believer, just from the world I've lived in, that oceanography has somewhat been a prerogative of the privileged. Do you know what I mean? This is a Woods Hole oceanographic boat. I think it costs $50 million, all right? It costs $20,000 a day. Our boat, the Odyssey, could cost us up to $2,000 a day. And if you think of all of these countries around the world, all of these coastlines, there literally aren't thousands of these boats, as there should be. I think there's less than 30 of these big oceanographic research vessels, and often they're not offshore all the time. So we've got to find a way to collect data on our oceans in an affordable manner, in a replicable manner, and we need sort of non-invasive, persistent ocean monitoring. I will admit, I read that off the screen. Anyway, there's also a catch-22 with endangered species. You tend to get two different camps, okay? And the camp on one side is saying, we need to collect all the data, you know, we're losing them, we've got to find out why we're losing them. We've got to get all the data we can so we can try to save them. And then the group on the other side said, no, don't do anything that might hasten their demise. And it's a difficult question. What do you do? What is the answer to this sort of catch-22? Well, let's talk a little bit about what Roger has been known for doing in his career, and I'm hopefully sort of following him. By the way, a fun photo. This is me with hair, and this is Roger with hair. So there we go. Can you believe this? In 1990, I was on a beach with Roger Payne in Argentina, and what did Roger want to do? He wanted to get something up in the air so we could look down and observe how the whales were doing. And here we are. I would say 28 years later. I have to say, I wasn't enamored with all of Roger's idea, because in the front, in the front there, we have a parasail. Well, it's hardly benign because the whale's in the water and there's little inflatables going, meow, meow, meow. But Roger said, I got a better idea. I've got a helium balloon. We'll put up this helium balloon. So we're down in Argentina, and guess what? They didn't have helium. So we had to use hydrogen. This is me. I feel this should be one of these TV shows. Yes, I'm a whale biologist, you know. So, and actually it was a little scary because I guess when hydrogen burns, you can't see it. So anyway, here we are down in Argentina, you know, developing benign research techniques. Now, and this is fun. Can you see yourself? Rick is actually, by the way, Rick in the front here is wearing the red hat. That's me in the white hat. To collect biological samples from whales, we typically biopsy them. So there's a special arrow with a flotation collar and a crossbow. And again, we came up with the whale boom here, so the boat didn't have to be right next to the whale. But I hope you could see, it's difficult. It's difficult to collect biological samples from whales. And I'll tell you, 1 year in the Gulf of Mexico, I think Rick might have even been on board, I felt like I was playing that game whack-a-mole, do you know what I mean? Because a whale would come up and we'd race over, and just before we got there, it would dive. And then a whale would come up and we'd race over and it would dive. By the way, ripping up $100 bills at the same time, thinking about my donor report, you know? So I'm like, God, there's got to be a better way. And then I remember it quite well. It was one evening, you know, we're running out of time, and it was a big male, and we really need this day, and I got really close, and it was just too far, and it dove. And as I was sort of crying there, this cloud of yucky, stinky snot went all over me, and hopefully my training as a biologist went, wow, you know, yucky, stinky, and smelly typically means you've got something interesting going on. And you can see here, all whales exhale, and I'm sure you've all heard of a breathalyzer. You know, a breathalyzer is they're measuring blood alcohol. And when we shoot a biopsy, we're really getting a legacy sample, a historic sample of what's happened to the animal. It doesn't help tell us what's going on now, okay? So I did a little bit of research, and there was a lady called Araceva Whitehouse, okay, who tried it with a helicopter, okay? And actually didn't work because it was a single column of air pushing down, and actually at that time it was like a little diesel engine which was polluting the stream. But I did find out that people in captivity had actually extracted hormones from, you know, animals' exhalation. So I said, okay, let's develop a drone to collect whale snot. And we decided we needed some erudite, intelligent, thoughtful name, which I can tell you Roger loved, and of course, Snotbot came to mind. And I will tell you, by the way, this year, Houghton Mifflin are releasing an early reader book, you know, for kids that don't read, to try to get them to read, and that book is called Snotbot. Anyway, I've always liked making things, but I'm just amazed how the technology has moved forward. So, in 2011, I was building my own drones, and you know, all of these people in the front row can tell you, they were, including my wife, they were like, what are you doing? I'm like, I'm building a drone, and the number of times I can tell you, I've come up to my friend's house, and it's like flown into a bush or something like that, they're like, carry on, Ian. But anyway, so we started with it, but then I had, the next problem is, you know, when I was talking to the permitting authorities, they said, you can't go test some prototype over an endangered species. You've got to prove it. So I'm like, well, how the heck do I prove it? And actually, it is right here, and this is Snot Shot. And basically, this is a little compressed air gun, okay? We fill it up with compressed air. We actually have 3D printed blowholes here for different whales, okay? And basically, the drone would fly over, and Snot Shot, there we go, you can see the Snot Shot, would shoot up in the air, and these are different blowholes. So we did in-tank testing and we did it in the ocean, but then someone said, we've got to take it out in the ocean and try it for real. So we needed a platform, and here is, you might notice a theme going here is Snot Yacht. Okay, so, so let's just review. We've got Snot Bot, Snot Shot, and Snot Yacht. Anyway, at the end of the day, it worked, and we actually had to We actually had to sort of publish some papers. I'll talk about that. But through all of this, we proved the efficacy of Snotbot. And then we sat down and said, well, okay, sort of what are the goals? What's your hypothesis? And one of the key things that we really wanted to do, you know, often, I don't know if if there's any of these sort of early adapters, in the old days when some new piece of technology came along, it was almost impossible to use, it was incredibly expensive, it broke down all the time. So we're like, okay, we want to try to work on a tool that's user-friendly, field-friendly, that means when you leave the office and take it out in the ocean, it still works, affordable, scalable, and replicable. Scalable means somebody else could add something to it, and people could have different designs. And I'm excited, and you see here, we've got a little robotics club where we have people come in and they work with us, but it's been a great educator, I think, for people interested in STEM. And I hope any of you younger people here tonight will realize, you know, the field of biology, the field of electronics, you know, you do what you're good at, you know, whatever it is, but I'm sure you can turn it to some environmental tool, if not some sort of environmental miracle. What was interesting, of course, is the permitting was a nightmare. We had to write papers on sound, and I just could, you know, anyway, it doesn't matter, but it was a problem getting the permits. And in actual fact, and I'm sorry to admit this, one of the permit authorities recommended that I go out of the country, use the tool, prove its efficacy, come back in the country, and they give me a permit. So that's actually what happened. But there was another problem. How do you raise the money? I mean, no disrespect, I know there's some funders in the audience. How would have you been if I came up to you and said, I want to collect snot with a drone, you know? Anyway, I have to tell you, it's okay, but a lot of people turned us down. But we're very lucky, because we have one other secret weapon that's actually in this room tonight, which is a Shakespearean actor, Lisa Harrow, who's sitting in the front. Somehow she also happens to be married to Dr. Payne, but that's okay. Maybe Dr. Payne's married to Lisa. Yeah, but there you go. But anyway, Lisa knows the Shakespearean actor, Patrick Stewart, who I guess is quite well known from some science fiction series that I watch all the time, and I guess the X-Men series. And it really was wonderful. Lisa put me in touch, and I called up Patrick, and I said, Patrick, I want to harass you so that I can tell the story about collecting data without harassing whales. Patrick was like, bring it on. So here we go. Here's Sir Patrick Stewart. I'm just collecting data.
Man, what the heck is that? What is going on?
I'm just measuring your stress levels.
All right, Ian, enough of this harassment. I need to know what is going on.
I'm collecting your snot.
Why do you need my tissue with my snot on it?
Come outside and I'll explain it to you.
What's going on here?
We're really looking for ways to collect biological data without harassing the animals. And here comes our drones we affectionately call Snotbot. Ocean Lion, I'm going to move on, but how cool is it to have Sir Patrick Stewart saying, why do you want my handkerchief with my snot on it? He was a real character, trust me. All right, so I'm actually going to give you a little video here. Here's a snot collection video, and we actually, I fly the drone, what's called FPV. So I'm looking down a little camera and looking at a view. So this first snot collection, it's going to be as if you were the drone pilot. This is what I see, okay? This is one of our funders, thank them. So, look at all that snot just going to waste there. Where's my little red button? Throwing it. So whales actually are what they call explosive breathers. You know, we're breathing out at sort of 6 to 10, 8 miles an hour. They're blowing out at 40, 50 miles an hour. So this is actual real time. I'm slowly going up to the whale. Can you see the blowhole there? The whale's coming up, so I'm just going to move over and bingo, you've been snotted. So I think what's interesting, by the way, does that animal look stressed? That animal doesn't even know that we collected biological data. And actually, this next video I just want to show you is a slow-mo, because people are like, are you getting all the salt water? And we're not. We're actually, so this is a slow motion. So just watch this here. So you see, here's the blowhole. Can you see? So look at that, totally clear of the water. So this is exhaled, by the way, this is exhaled breath condensate that's coming out, and because they're blowing out little bits of tissue and all that type of stuff. And if you think about it, you know, I'm sure you've all coughed and all this sort of ugly stuff comes up, and that ugly stuff is priceless biological information. Thank you. But you know what's cool is that basically all we've done, if you've looked at these drones, we tried all these complicated things. We tried great absorption sponges, which sucked up all the snot, but then we couldn't get the snot out of the sponge, you know? You wouldn't believe it. The first time I went down to Mexico, I took a small centrifuge with me. I mean, I should have videoed it, because the customs guy was like, you've got a drone to collect snot, and you've got a centrifuge. And I'm like, yep. Get out of here. Just go, will you, you know? Actually, it was even better when I came back into the country and I actually had pink whale poop and whale snot, because blue whales are eating krill, which are pink. So anyway, the customs people just loved pink whale poop. And I'm digressing. Anyway, so what's happening though is we've got these Petri dishes, the whale exhales onto them, and then we have this little sort of scraper. It's almost my favorite sound is, well, you can't hear, it's like, reep, reep, reep. In the evening, I'm there back at our hotel room and I can hear Andy going, reep, reep, scraping it all down. He sucks up the snot with this little pipette, puts it in a little cryo valve, okay, and then we send it off to different labs for analysis. So actually, this is an interesting one. Here's the drone here showing you a crosswind snot collection. And by the way, just notice how stressed these animals are. But you can really see, look at that. It's just sitting there. This will play a couple of times. It's just sitting there and bingo. You know, you've been snotted. It's an oldie, but it's a goodie. The other thing that's been amazing, and again, I'll talk more about this, but we're just seeing things we've never seen before. Roger and I have a friend called Fred Sharp, who's been in Alaska studying whales for 30 years, this population for 30 years. We took him out with us one day with drone footage. He's like, I've never seen them do that. I didn't know they did that. I mean, we are transforming the ways that people do whale research with a $2,000 drone. Oh, and you need someone who knows how to use the remote. I'm hoping we're not... Oh, wait a minute, it looks like we're having the computer might be... Let's keep going. All right, here we go. Don't let me down. You see? Oh, it's, okay, good, there we go. So, but we've just seen behaviors that, you know, you can't see this stuff sitting in a boat. And all of this stuff is time-coded, you know, so we know what's going on. By the way, some of the shots, we actually have a second drone up in the air following the first drone, so we can see if the animals respond to their activities. You can almost see the krill in the water here. But it's just so exciting, the data we get. And you know, I will admit, I'm you know, it's pretty damn exciting flying these drones and just seeing this behavior. And people have done some of this work with a helicopter and an airplane, but it's dangerous. This drone can sit 30 feet above the animal. It's got no idea you're there. So you're really getting a real snapshot into the lives of these animals. It has been fun. I don't always take myself seriously. I take the work seriously. I don't take myself seriously. But you sometimes have to wonder here. This is down in Argentina off the camp that Roger established. And we're sitting in this boat here, okay? I'm actually here flying the drone. And this is Carolyn. And Carolyn actually has a stainless steel tray on her lap where everything's sterile. So she's like, I'm on my own. She's doing all the sterile stuff. And we'd actually been following this animal two or three times, trying to collect its snot. And it basically swam right over the boat, rolled over sideways, and snot. I mean, look at that. Carolyn got absolutely nailed. I mean, it's like, I mean, can you imagine, again, going back to your supporter, well, my experiment was ruined by the whale. So wait, the whale you were studying ruined your experiment. That's correct. Okay. Anyway, this next one was funny. Down in the Sea of Cortez, I recommend all of you go there. There's a friendly gray whale place in San Ignacio Lagoon. And we went there to do our initial trials because I didn't want to have to fly out half a mile to a whale, come back, fly out. Because these animals get 10 or 20 feet away from the boat, we could try lots of different experiments, all the different sort of collectors. And this was us all taking a little bit a break for a minute and getting a different side of snot, you could say. Right in his face. I mean, we were getting nailed here. I think the best part is Christian, our cameraman at the end, he just thought this was the coolest thing that's ever happened to him. We got a rainbow on that one. Look at Christian, he's like, this is really cool. I've been snotted! And actually, by the way, a lot of those photographs, we've been very lucky. Christian's an award-winning cinematographer, and he's traveled with us around the world, and his photographs have really helped us tell our story. So I've intimated to this, but what is it's almost unbelievable with Snotbot, because typically you get an electric drill, drills holes. A hammer, hammers nails and pulls nails out. It's just crazy the data we get. I mean, I've talked about this, we've got the biological data, DNA, microbiomes, hormones, you know, stress hormones. Photogrammetry, and I'm going to show you another shot, is where you can measure an animal with a, I'm going to show you another photograph, but if you look at this, these are a couple of whales from our camp down in Argentina. You see how fat that is? See how fat the baby is? And then this is the same time of year in North America. This is the northern right whale. And right there, look how skinny this animal is to that animal. So right out of there, you don't have to be a 100-year trained scientist to be able to say, okay, clearly these animals aren't getting enough food. But it's just amazing the data we're getting. And I'm telling everyone that I'm sort of some brilliant person, you know, no ego here. But actually what I'm doing is, somebody on the left comes up with a very cool sensor, and someone on the right comes up with a really cool drone, and I just stick them together with duct tape and glue and then say, genius. So here's just showing you photogrammetry again. So if we made a little height LiDAR measurement kit, so we know the height, but we can measure the size of the animals. And again, if you've got three whales in the screen, we can measure the height of all of them. I'm very excited about a new breakthrough we've made, and it's sort of unpublished data. And I hope this slide is gonna make some sense. So give me a minute here. So we're using this thermal camera. Okay, it's actually this drone and this camera. And it's got two lenses on it, and what's happening is it's taking a regular photograph and a thermal photograph at the same time, okay? But these two are just a snapshot. It's actually shooting a video. So here, okay, is the temperature, all right, from the video. Does that make sense? So this is very hot, this is very cool. And what's going on here, this is the whale exhaling, and see as the temperature cools down, that's it inhaling. So that's the animal. So you don't get a thermal reading through the snot, but when it starts inhaling, you get this. So this is the inhalation. Then here's the next blow, inhalation. And guess what? It's getting cooler as it's sucking in the cooler air from the outside. So here's the third blow. And then if you actually look at the fourth blow, by the way, that line means it's actually that animal right there. So this shot is that animal. But look at this. The fourth blow is fatter than all the other blows, you know, or the fourth inhalation is fatter than the other ones. Clearly, I don't know if any of you have done any snorkeling, right before you take a dive, you take a big breath. Now, I don't know about you guys, but my doctor, I go in to pay the bill, and they take my blood pressure and the temperature. No one's ever taken the temperature of a whale. And the key thing about this is we're looking down 6 to 8 inches inside the blowhole to get the thermal temperature. We don't have to go in there. There's a problem with thermal cameras because they have emitted radiation, reflected radiation. So when you're looking at the surface of something, you can't guarantee it's the actual temperature. But when you're looking down inside, you can. So this is very exciting. And again, so imagine this. Imagine going to the doctor, sitting in the office, opening a magazine, reading for 10 minutes, and the doctor comes out and says, you're fine, pay the bill, go home. On one level, this is what we're doing. We are doing health checks of these animals, and they don't even know it. And here's one I just mentioned to Roger when I came in the door, and I don't even know what's going on here, but you see here is the regular foot. So these photographs were taken at the same time. Look at this. Well, what are these spots here? They're not here, you know? There's a blowhole. I think there's a little spot right there. Clearly the dorsal area is hot, but what are these spots? So what are we learning? I mean, certainly we know with humans, sometimes when they're sick, they can have hot spots and something on their body. So it's a really exciting time to be in this particular field. And I can tell you that the education component has been great. I have this little club, and these kids came in, and they actually made CBS Boston because they were making a height sensor for Snotbot. They loved it. But I think, almost going back to this earlier shot, every country we've been to, we've left them with a drone. And actually, I'll show you in a minute, but it's exciting that we're showing them how to use the tools, we're leaving them with protocols, we're training them, and then they're carrying on the work after us I think it might be this next shot. It was actually quite funny. So this is a shot actually. So I was just in West Africa, and it was in a location that you couldn't really do a regular research expedition with a boat because it was very dangerous. So this is one of the shots we took. It actually turns out this was an illegal gold mining activity that was going on up the coast. And they actually told us, by the time they find out about this, the gold miners have gone. So Snotbot, guess what, has helped catch illegal gold miners. I mean, it's crazy. So we now actually have a Drones for Whale research program where we've got Earbot. This is Earbot right here. Often when you record a whale sound, the boat that you're in is making noise. You can hear your own boat, which messes up the sound, or you leave the hydrophone on the bottom, but then what happens if the whale swims off? Basically, Earbot flies over to where the whales are, lands in the water, records the sounds, okay, and then the whales swim off. You can take off and go fly it and land it again. I will tell you, the first time we used Earbot, remember I've been working with Roger 30 years now, the first time we used it, it was in the water, the whales swim off, and I said, okay guys, let's go get the drone. And my whole team were like, what do you mean go get the drone? We could just lift it off. I mean, I'm still programmed in the old way of doing science. But anyway, I think there's lots of fun stuff going on. We're talking about hyperspectral cameras for looking at ocean plastics, swarm, groups of drones. This is actually a fixed-wing airplane. We're helping with disentanglement. And I really think you're going to hear more and more about sort of conservation drones, drones for good. And it's a really exciting time. And obviously, I'm enjoying it. On this page, just this page, we had 2 million views. 2 million views. And you know what's exciting? And this is why, again, I appreciate being here with the Hanover Conservancy. People don't think the oceans affect their lives. The oceans is affecting all of your lives. I think I said, 2 out of every 3 breaths you take come from the oceans. You may be living up in here, in Hanover, but you are an ocean species, in my mind. And you know what? We've got lots of people looking at the ocean, paying more attention to the ocean. Some of them saying, well, that's a stupid name, but it doesn't matter. This was a fun piece, actually, on NBC News. I hope.
The images, quite simply, are breathtaking. A low pass over a pod of humpback whales cruising off Alaska. Slowly, the camera moves closer, and then this. The biggest animal on the planet exhales, all of it blowing right into the face of a drone hovering just 12 feet above.
It's that stuff that's coming out that's full of this priceless information, you know, on whale biology.
Dr. Ian Kerr says that priceless data is what the petri dishes mounted on the drone are collecting. Live biological samples from deep inside a whale's lungs.
DNA, microbiomes, you know, that make your whole body work. We've got stress hormones, pregnancy hormones.
All in the petri dish.
All in the petri dishes.
And not just Alaskan humpbacks. Off the coast of Mexico, the drone flew the full length of this massive blue whale. The whale, says Kerr, probably thinks the drone is a bird.
For perspective, this boat is 13 feet long. A gray whale is 50 feet long. A blue whale, 100 feet. A perspective best captured by a drone.
Like this view of a mother nursing her calf. At Oregon State University, Scott Baker is now adding those DNA samples to a catalog of 3,000 whales, analyzing their age, health, and any sign of environmental threat.
It's not just about learning about this population now, but about understanding it over the next 10, 20, even 50 years.
While some whale populations are slowly recovering from near extinction, others are still in danger. More information could help save them.
I think we sort of hit the lottery here. You know, it's almost like the invention of the microscope for cellular biologists.
A scientific jackpot to save a giant of the seas. Tom Costello, NBC News, Gloucester, Massachusetts.
I mean, on one level, you can't make this stuff up, you know, but here's Roger introducing the former Secretary of State, John Kerry, and Theresa Hines. Look at him. He's loving it. He's loving it. So, no, I mean, it's amazing. And I almost, even to some of the younger people in the audience, you know, if somebody says you've got a crazy idea, you know, pursue it, be methodical about it. But honestly, I had no idea that, you know, 4 years after I sort of came up with this crazy drone idea, I would be invited to stand in front of the General Assembly at the United Nations and talk to them about democratizing science with drones. So we're closing up now. Again, the future, I think we're going to do more and more sort of putting different drones together. I mean, the interesting one we're looking at now, we're using artificial intelligence. The problem, most whales are actually identified by their tails, okay? So the problem with that is animals that lift up their tails don't lift up their tails all the time. And some animals don't ever lift up their tails. But what do all whales do, as what do all humans do? They breathe. And if we just look at our noses, I bet your neighbor's nose is different to your nose. So I think different blowholes will have a different shape. So we're now using machine learning to identify different whales' blowholes while we're up there. Oh, by the way, doing photogrammetry, collecting snot, and thermal visioning. It's pretty exciting. Clearly, I need better technology. The one thing we're very interested in is what stresses an animal. And it's hard on one level for us to sort of equate with a whale. You know, imagine a blue whale, tongue weighs 8 tons, it's 140 tons in weight, 98 feet long. I mean, you can't equate with a whale, but believe it or not, it's a mammal like us, and it gets stressed. And I'm not going to read, oh, wait a minute, I'm not going to read all of these out, but the great thing is that when we tell the story of whales, when we understand what stresses whales, people can understand it. So we can say, if you have a shipping lane here, you'll stress the whale, let's move it over. People can understand that and change policy. And actually, tonight you're all very lucky, because I managed to get this stress test, so we're going to find out how stressed all of you are, and let me tell you how it works. So I'm going to put up a photograph, okay? And there are two dolphins in the photograph. And if they look identical, you are not stressed. And the more discrepancies you see between the dolphins, likely the more stressed you are. So give it a minute, because it might not be obvious, give it a minute and look at the photo and tell me what you think. They look identical to me, I know. Clearly you're all way too stressed. You're way too stressed. So people also do ask about Ocean Alliance, and I tell people, well, Ocean Alliance, we're not ocean alone, we like working with people. So when you have scientific data, it's all about putting that data into context. You can't just collect data, you need to be able to put it into context. And I think the model that Roger established that Ocean Alliance is working with different groups. Right now, these are all the different groups we're working with doing analysis on our data. So all of these groups are writing papers. No single group could write all these papers, but they're happy. They don't have to get all the permits I have to get to fly. I'm happy I don't have to buy a DNA analysis machine. So that is what the Alliance is. And if we weren't busy enough, the Annenberg Foundation kindly purchased this building for us in Gloucester, Mass. And we've you can tell here, we've pretty much finished two of the buildings, but we're turning what was a polluted site on the Gloucester waterfront into this oceanographic sort of innovation and education center. Again, I'm not going to speak, you've been very patient, but the whole idea is to drive innovation, disseminate data, accelerate research and build solutions. Again, with this blue economy, I think it's a really exciting time to sort of be involved in oceanography. And I thought, my daughter is actually into musical theater, so I thought I might end with a song. Hang on a minute. Wait. Okay, you know what? I won't sing. What I will do is I will put up a song that Roger recorded many years ago that is now out in deep space. So the Voyager 1 in spacecraft, Voyager 1 and 2 spacecraft have gone out into deep space. They're now in the heliosphere where the solar winds of other suns are stronger than the solar wind from our sun. It doesn't make any sense to me, hopefully it does to some of you, but I think it means it's way the heck out there. And guess what? There's a little gold record, okay, with Roger's whale songs on them. I think what we can do is we can end the talk tonight. So one animal sort of circulating the air here. For hosting me tonight, and let's keep the blue planet blue. Thank you very much. Did everyone hear that? So, a great question. Thank you very much. So actually, I mean, really good question. Typically, you know, actually, here's a challenge. I actually think the first blow, I think, is probably the best blow. Without being silly, you know, if you ever sneezed, it seems to get less productive as you go down. Sorry, but we're talking biology here. Come on. So anyway, it gets less productive. The reality is, though, it's almost impossible to be on the whale for the first blow. Depending on the species, we will often get three or four blows. I mean, if we've got three blows, I can typically get it. The funny thing is, you know, just to, so you're clear though, it is funny in some situations. Sometimes an animal will relax and you'll see it, it'll come up and it'll blow twice and I'll get there and over it and I'm like, let's go, and it will go. You're like, what? You know? And then 20 feet away, an animal's going, you know. But yeah, so we, luckily they blow three or four times, and we have had the data analyzed, and we are successfully collecting sort of all of this different stuff. We've even sent samples in to see if we get any pollutants in it, because certain metals like mercury actually sort of chelate. You can find them in your hair. So we don't know if there's enough at a microscopic level. And then there's ketones, some energetics. I mean, I think they almost say with any new tool, you typically underestimate the potential. I mean, like, look at the iPhone. I'm not saying this is the iPhone, but you know what I mean? I think it's an exciting future. Whoa, I went way off track there, I'm sorry. Anybody else? Any questions? Yes, sir.
The data that you collect, are you tagging that to individual whales and so that you have a record on a per whale basis?
Yeah, did everyone hear that? Are we? Yeah, exactly. And that's actually, we worked with Intel last year. If you go on our website, you can see the Intel video. Absolutely doing that. And what we're now trying to do is, again, using machine learning and AI, is do that in real time. So actually, I was with it in Alaska last summer with Intel. They had this computer that they had to bring a generator with just to run the computer. But while I was flying, they ID'd the whale I was above. And that's a 30-minute flight. And they said, oh, this is, I can't remember, George, that was last seen 15 miles from here, which is so exciting because often you have a hypothesis, you sort of go out in the field, you collect the data, and you find you didn't get this data, or you didn't see that, or you didn't realize the reality that we're sort of photo IDing the animal that we're over, we're having the computers work that out, is very exciting, not just in, you know, because maybe that animal that had a ship strike last year, so we want to spend more time with it to see if it's got scars or if it's healed or if it's pregnant or whatever. So the answer to your question was yes, but clearly I don't know how to make a question short or an answer short. Yes, madam. Yeah, I didn't hear what that woman said, so another great question. Have we been able to change policy with the samples we've got? We have not. And the reason why is we've had the data, it's been affirmed, but the data set is still small. You know, when you talk about biopsies, there are probably, Roger, tell me, 50,000, 100,000 biopsies that have been taken over 10 decades. Yet right now there's like 300 snot collections. So the feeling is that the number we have is not enough. But for example, I think it's going to be interesting, I don't know if Roger wants to comment on this, but it's so easy for us, I don't think anthropomorphizing is correct, but it's so easy for us to say, well, they won't like that, or they, do you know what I mean? If they live in a world of sound, they might hate this noise. But maybe if they live in a world of sound, they have the capacity to accommodate that noise. Do you know what I mean? And certainly, if you can collect data without stressing the animal, we should be able to answer that question. So that's where we're going. And I'm hoping at the latest by 2020, and that's part of the idea of going back to the Gulf of Mexico to look at the air gun thing, because that's quite an intrusive behavior. And, you know, maybe it doesn't stress them. I mean, common sense says it does. Roger, you have any comments on that?
There are things which cause problems that you would never think an animal could get used to, but don't forget that in the case of hooping cranes, they have led hooping cranes to former areas where hooping cranes once nested by having them be imprinted on chainsaw motors that are driving propellers on hang gliders, basically. And that's fine. They'll follow that enthusiastically. In fact, try to stop them from following it. You just can't. So there are huge surprises of what animals will and won't tolerate. I, of course, would love to see everything return to the silence of the past, which is where we all fell in love with nature. And let's hope we can get in that direction.
Yeah, thank you, Rob. Thank you, Rob. But I think, again, to any young biologist, you know, this is exciting. Now, we may have one up there. Yes, sir?
How does snot bot collect snot?
How does it collect the snot?
Yeah.
Well, you know, I have this little dish over here on the drone. I don't know if you can sneeze on command here. But what happens is we've got these dishes. And I don't think we'll have you spit on this. I don't think your family would appreciate it. But see all these little dishes here? So basically, you know, there you go. So see where your mom's touching? If you touch those dishes, imagine a whale is just spitting onto that dish. And there it is. And quite seriously, if you spat on it, do you ever watch any of these detective shows where these scientists be able to see your DNA and see who you are? That's all we're doing. It's amazing what a little piece of biology can tell you. You can have my job in 10 years. You got that? Good. Thank you. Anybody else while I'm up here? I guess so, yeah.
Do you also collect whale poop and what information you get from that?
Oh, yeah, whale poop. Roger's already exhausted by Snotbot, and when we start talking poopbot, I may get fired, you know. So actually, we are collecting the poop. And the poop goes back to your question, because we're trying to validate the efficacy of the sample. You know, is this a real sample? Are the hormones truly elevated? And that's hard to do. But those same hormone levels you'll see in the defecation. So if we can compare what we find in the defecation with what we find in the blow, that really helps. And actually, we're also very interested in the poop, as we call it, because I hate to tell you, because of microplastics. because whales are these, you know, whales are basically swimming around, skimming the ocean or gulping the ocean in these areas that are full up with microplastics. So we're deeply concerned as to, you know, how much microplastics these animals are ingesting. So, but keeping poop, snot, yes, sir, yes.
Flying low over the ocean with the drone, I would think it might lose some drones.
Oh my gosh. I'm the pilot. You're not thinking. I don't. Can we turn the mic off? No. Yeah, we have lost a couple, but typically it's been pilot error. Like, we actually just lost one in Africa where basically one of the team hadn't put the propeller on properly. So, but we started by making waterproof drones because of the snot, but we found to make it waterproof made it very heavy. And actually, I mean, you should look at this drone later. It's all rusty. I mean, this drone has taken probably 200 snot samples in three different countries, and it's still flying. And it's not even advertised as a waterproof drone. By the way, this was the original drone that we made, and I was explaining, you ever seen those little LED garden lights? These are the tubes from the garden lights, because I kept breaking the legs, and it's been a lot of fun. And I do want to go back to where Roger was, to all of you. It's an exciting time to be in biology. So we've got another biologist up here. Yes, madam. So did you hear that? What did the snot look like? Well, you know what? I hate to tell you, it's probably like, have you ever sneezed into a tissue? And it's sort of like, you haven't? Okay. It's just a little thicker than water, and sometimes there can be little spots in it, which are actually little bits of slough skin that the animal's exhaling. But yeah, and it smells very fishy. It's not a nice smell. It's sort of like a rotten fish smell. So it's you know, and it gets in your clothes. And but now, so does that answer your question? Is that good? Yeah. What does it look like? Yucky is probably the answer. But yes, madam.
How do you imagine that? That the
towel's
going in the water.
You know what? Somebody help me with that. I think that's what's called a bad sense of humor. That was just me trying to be silly. It's a dad joke. There you go.
I'm never
going to
get my dad's dad joke.
Well, I don't know. Are we good there? Certainly, yeah. Oh, yes, yeah, so on. Yeah.
And you have the lot over one whale. So you collect sample from that whale and then go back and
exactly.
Sample. You don't get two or three because then it would be
yeah, exactly.
Try another.
Exactly. And typically, if you probably didn't notice, but in that case, I'll typically always choose the upwind whale first. Do you know what I mean? And then often we'll choose an animal that has no scars on it. So you've got four animals, and some of them have got scars on it, and they move around. Often they seem to maintain their patterns, which again is so much easier to see from above. But yeah, well, but that actually is a problem. If they stay close together and if they keep swimming in the same direction, you know, I've had an occasion where I just couldn't get whale number two because whale number two was always in the snot cloud of whale number one. I mean, for goodness sake. But anyway. Well, I think, thank you all very much for your interest. I really appreciate it.